Hi, this is Ioannis. This is the fifth lecture of the PhD course on smart environments. This is the last course that we will do over the more software-oriented software development parts. Immediately after this lecture, Francesco will pick up and will present a series of research issues, which of course are very interesting and build upon all the work we have done so far. So in the previous lectures, we've seen some core services of the AWS cloud-based ecosystem. We saw how to set up some elastic instances, how to store different kind of files on the cloud, how to connect devices, how to connect internet-enabled devices with the IoT device gateway, this MQTT broker. And then we saw, apart from the security aspects related to authentication and authorization, we saw how to examine and inspect each message arriving to the device gateway. We saw how we can take advantage of the structure of the messages. So if the messages are structured using as JSON objects, we saw how we can use an SQL syntax in order to build rules in order to inspect each one of these messages and then invoke a series of other services based on this packet-based processing. So, for example, we saw when the messages arrive with a certain value above a threshold, how to create notifications, short notifications, using the AWS SMS services for the generation of email alerts or SMS alerts. Then, of course, we can also create a kind of a filtering in this way. So this messages that match certain criteria are then forwarded to another topic, to another MQTT topic. And in this way, instead of monitoring all the raw data, we can only monitor the filtered messages. And we also did some examples with the IoT analytics service of AWS. Essentially, this is a service that allows us to collect all these messages, either the unfiltered, the raw data arriving from all the devices, or using some filter, a narrowed down view based on a specific time, a specific location, specific that is specific devices or specific readings, we can collect all these filtered messages in order to create the so-called data stores, and then based on these data stores periodically create data sets, batches of values, batches of sensor data that can then be forwarded to another service. And of course, this kind of batches, this data set are very important, are crucial, so that we can move to the next step of processing. And I will come back to that very, very shortly. So what we've seen so far is this cloud-based architecture, where the gateway that connects the left side, the wireless network, essentially brings all the messages, all the data to the MQTT broker, to this device gateway, and essentially moves all the data transfers all the data to our cloud-based computational platform. So this is what we've seen so far. And today, of course, we will move a step forward towards a more, let's say, edge-based architecture. So this is one thing that we are going to discuss this lecture, how to move, how to shift some of the services from the cloud to the edges, to this gateway device. And another thing that we are going to see this in this lecture is how to move from this message-based, packet-based inspection of the data to a much more broader analysis of data. So, of course, it is important to carry out this analysis per packet, this packet-based analysis that we saw during the last lecture. Of course, this is important to extract information related to, let's say, first-level analysis of the packets. However, in order to move to the higher levels of this IoT value pyramid that we discussed in the first lectures, it is very important to have a broader view to be able to analyze data beyond a single packet in order to extract answer more meaningful questions. And this is what we are going to do today. We are going to see how we can analyze, how we can use services, software frameworks in order to analyze, to carry out a data-driven analysis of the data arriving from the sensors and how we can use these frameworks to develop services. Of course, we will start from the cloud-based approach. We will start by building upon the techniques and the services we saw in the previous lectures, and this is our starting point, a cloud-based IoT applications. So since we are in the cloud, let's see now how we can process all these packets arriving from the different sensors. So a green box here might represent values arriving from temperature sensors from different stations, or it might represent all the values coming from station number one, while red are the values arriving from station number two. Though this is an abstract point of view, it doesn't matter. For this example, what we have in mind. Now, we wish to process this data, and of course there are many different ways to process them. Most of the times, if not all of the times, this is application specific. So our end user, our service needs us to produce certain statistics. And here, of course, we shouldn't go into the question if we need all these statistics. These are statistics that we need to produce after consulting our clients, after understanding that there is a clear need for them. This is not the kind of an exercise. We are not wasting our resources. So we produce statistics in over a predefined period of time, like the average value, average temperature every hour, every day, every week, every month, the maximum, the minimum. Really depends on what we want to do. And in some cases, we also need to understand that the raw values of the sensors might not give any actual meaning. Like when we consider the intensity of the rain and the the strength of the wind. Maybe we have a gust, so we have a temporary increase or decrease in the intensity of the rain. Maybe the latest value is not enough to provide an indication. The same with the direction. Maybe there is a small shift in the direction of the wind. So here, producing the average intensity of the last minute or the last 5 minutes might be more accurate than giving the last value. So statistics might be also necessary to be carried out continuously, not every end of the day or every end of the month, to better organize our system. So this is something which is part of the data processing. Another part of the data processing, of course, are data mining tasks. We would like to examine the data and identify anomalies. Anomalies might be related to weird phenomena, or, for example, not so weird phenomena like clouds obscuring the station, and now the temperature drops, but this is because of the clouds. So we need to identify these anomalies, or we would like to identify seasonality, examine whether this week is behaving like this day within the week or this hour within the day. We need to analyze the data, examine the data, combine the data with other data sources, and identify correlations. So there are different levels of processing of the data. We could also use machine learning algorithm, deep neural networks. There are many, many things that we can do. Of course, these are not part of this course. So this is something that needs to be done. And if you remember the Gaia project we discussed a few weeks ago, this smart school architecture, this cloud-based smart school architecture, on the left side, again, we have the values, the sensor values collected by the stations deployed within the classrooms, within the schools, within the buildings of the schools, monitoring electricity, monitoring the conditions of the rooms, also monitoring weather, monitoring different aspects, environmental aspects. Here, of course, we don't have just two stations, we don't have two locations. We have more than, we have hundreds of stations feeding sensor values into our cloud-based infrastructure. And here, data are stored in order to have access to historic values. We have organized different kinds of organizations of the data in caches, in short-term and long-term caches, to facilitate the websites, to facilitate the applications and the way that the values are displayed with the lowest possible latency. So, of course, this is an engineering part to develop a system that is efficient and can scale. And, of course, here we have data analysis at different levels. We identify missing values. Sensors might be disconnected. We identify values that are not correct. We produce statistics. We carry out certain data analytics tasks specific for each application. We produce data in order to generate plots, reports, and so on. So this is something that, of course, needs to be developed. Requires an effort in order to be delivered. And here, the starting point for the discussion that we are going to do now is the AWS IoT Analytics service that we saw last lecture. Once again, we have data arriving from the rules engine. So for our case, it is data arriving from the sensors through the device gateway, through the MQTT broker. We collect all this data, and then in the next step of the IoT analytics, we are processing these packets. Essentially, we are enriching them. Here we have the option to enrich them using external sources. And then these values are stored in the so-called data stores, where we can essentially create the so-called data sets that are then used as input for our, let's say, machine learning analysis or whatever other kind of analysis that we want to do. So here we have the input arriving from the sensors, which is organized into batches that are being executed under a framework like Hadoop, like Spark, like Flink. There are many, many frameworks here, and then the result is produced with all the values. So here today we are going to see some examples based on the Apache Flink framework. There are generic examples. They could easily be implemented using Apache Spark, but there are also many, many other frameworks but for batch-based processing available under Amazon Web Services, like under Azure, like Google, under ThingsBoard, or independently outside these providers. So in this example, we assume that data arrive as a data set, as a file data set, file-based data set. This is just an abstraction. Of course, we can retrieve values from our NoSQL database, from our key value store. We can retrieve values from our SQL database, or if we have a message bus which is more advanced than MQTT. Recall that MQTT is a cut down message bus system, doesn't support many features, so that it is fast. MQTT SN is even further narrowed down in size, but there are, of course, on the other end of the spectrum, more products with much richer features like Kafka, like RabbitMQ, message buses that are much more advanced. So we could even use these message buses to collect the values. But in this example, we just assume a file. So it is the values are organized in files, either in CSV format or JSON. This is not so important. And these values, after being loaded, they are organized based on different transformations. So here we could group them based on their sensor value. We can filter them if they are above or below a threshold. And then, of course, after we have done all these different transformations, we can compute different kinds of aggregates, identify minimum, maximum averages, standard deviation, whatever kind of statistical function we want to compute. So this is an example of such a kind of an operation. So data are continuously ingested into our system, but periodically we are producing these slices of our data set. We produce this 1 hour data set in this example, so we want to compute the average temperature in the past hour. So after grouping data, we are executing this job, this grouping and counting job on this data set. And this is done, of course, for the first hour, and then for the second hour, a second one, and then for the third hour, a third one, right? So this is a batch job that is executed periodically. And in this way, we build hour by hour our statistics. Here, it is important to understand that there are certain moving parts in this approach. So, starting from the left side, where we have the data arriving from the sensors, and all the way to the right part, where we are servicing these values to our end users, either through a web page or to their mobile phones, or like alerts or like reports. The first step, of course, is the loading of the data. And here we need a kind of a distributed file system, if we are talking about file systems, or we need a kind of a database system that can accommodate large volumes of data, relying on the Hadoop file system. There are many distributed file systems that we can use. And there are many infrastructures that can deliver such kind of a file system and frameworks like Flume that we can rely on in order to produce this data and load this data into our system. And then, of course, we need the kind of a scheduler in order to make sure that our jobs are executed every hour, no matter the load, no matter if there are failures on the system, no matter how big our data. And again, here there are different frameworks, different tools that we can use. And finally, of course, the actual processing of the data, the batch processor, which could be Hadoop, which could be Spark, Flink, Lambdas, and so on. So here we have these moving parts. And of course, by organizing our data processing in this batch way, we are introducing a very, very specific latency, which is in fact quite high. So we are scheduling this batch job every X hours, and then, of course, the actual execution of this might take. It's not, of course, depends on the traffic, but it might take a lot of time. So it's not something that is automatic. It might take a lot of time, might require a lot of resources in order to execute. So here we also have a high latency. Now, another important thing that we need to keep in mind is that within our code, within our application, there was no notion of time in terms of organizing this batching, this periodicity, let's say. Time, in this sense, is implicit. We are not able to treat time, to control time programmatically. Time is treated outside our data processing application. Time is organized, is controlled by our administration, by our cloud administrators. It is controlled by the scheduler. It is part of a task carried out on the, let's say, Azure portal. Here time is part of the administrative tasks, and all these actions are essentially part of the DevOps, of the way that we have organized. And of course, we can automate some of them. We might write some scripts, but now these are two different things. One thing is time as part of the data processing task, and another thing is time within the scripts or the manual tasks that control the infrastructure. And here you can see that essentially the only way where time appears in our code is in the file name or in the select query of the values of the data arriving to us. So the actual data processing job does not have anything to do with the time and the definition of the period of time. And in this way, we are creating, we are processing the stream of data through this batch approach. And this is essentially the way that existing systems are producing statistics of the data. The majority of the examples and the majority of the tutorials rely on these technologies. And this is mainly because until now, stream processors, stream data processing, continuous analytics, if you want, was not mature. We didn't have frameworks mature enough, fast, like those used for batch processing. So batch processing, frameworks for batch processing developed much faster, and essentially it was considered something more important, since there are ways to implement solutions, custom solutions, to deliver stream-based processing based on these batch processors. And such kind of systems to deliver the end result. Of course, this led to systems that were more complicated, systems that required us to develop application-specific code, and thus systems that were prone to bugs and problems generated due to these bugs. Today, there are frameworks that are generic, they are stable, they are mature, that can take this task from us. So there is no need to set up such kind of batch systems, such kind of complex DevOps, such kind of series of administrative tasks. We can immediately implement our data analytics within such a generic stream processing framework. So there's no need to go through this batch concept. We have data produced continuously, so it's absolutely natural to continuously process this data in order to produce statistics. So we need to monitor data, and we need to react to this continuous data continuously. We should not be waiting for a day, for an hour, for a week to respond. We have a smart fleet of cars like Car2Go, and we need to know now if a car is running out of gas. We shouldn't wait for the end of the day to see the statistics. We should know now if there is a trouble in our system. We should be able to analyze without waiting the end of the month to get the statistics. And of course, we want to implement applications in a much easier way, that are not complex. Remember, it took you 1 week to build your first IoT infrastructure, and it was relatively the complexity was relatively reasonable. We want to do the same thing when we are building our continuous analytics, when we are building our IoT data analytics elements of our system. We don't want to have something complicated. We want to have something that is part of the same infrastructure. We are not bringing into different infrastructures that make things complicated. So we want to have a production of data live, continuously, maybe also directly facing our end users and feeding these results directly to the website in the first assignment. And we need this to be done efficiently, fast, as the number of sensors and as the number of users increases. We need to be consistent in the way that we are producing our statistics, correct. We shouldn't make mistakes. One time the window of 1 hour is computed in a different way than the next hour. And of course, we want to be manageable, simple, and then straightforward. Here, stream processing is an important element of IoT data processing, but we need to remember that streaming is not real time, right? We discussed about this a few weeks ago when we were examining different application scenarios. Real time is about responding within specific time constraints. So real time is a very, very strict quality of service requirement. We have to provide specific latencies. We have to react within a specific critical framework. While streaming doesn't have to be like that. So we might provide continuous data processing, but with a certain delay because of the volume of the data, because of the load of the processing we need to carry out. So maybe we are indeed continuously processing data. We are not waiting. We are not doing it in batch mode, but the complexity gives the results after a given time. There is a latency. So this is not real time anymore. It is continuous, but not real time. And vice versa. Real time might not be streaming. We might be skipping values. We might be sampling so that we can provide some values very, very fast, but not taking into consideration all the pieces of the puzzle. However, this does not mean that streaming applications cannot be fast. We can dedicate a large processing resources so that we can scale and produce our statistics fast. Consider that Netflix is based on stream-based analytics. Zolando is also doing the same, Alibaba. It's not necessary that streaming cannot be fast. And of course, we need to be able to react fast in some cases, to detect anomalies fast, to identify special events fast. Here, we shouldn't take unnecessary trade-offs. So we have the tools today to develop such kind of IoT data processing tasks without making such trade-offs. So here, going back to this left to right point of view, the data arriving from the sensors are continuously organized into windows. And we said that MQTT does not support this, but there are other messaging systems that do that, provide the ability of such kind of intermediate storage system. It is a kind of a storage system, creates this persistence, so we can have windows, and we will go into the details immediately after these slides. So here we can have the so-called message queue, which is then accessed by our stream processor in order to consistently process the values and then provide the results to the servicing layer. So in the architecture of the second assignment, we can directly connect our stream processor to the MQTT broker, subscribe to a specific channel, produce the results, and then store them in the database so that then they can be accessed from the website and delivered to our clients and users. Of course, this is not the only architecture. We could avoid the data store. We could post these values, publish these values back to the broker, and then through this new channel have them delivered to the website. It's completely up to us how to organize our architecture. This is just an example. So now the organization of streams into these windows has some certain semantics connected to it. One first important element is to understand how these windows are organized. Are they time-driven, like the discussion we had till now? So is this a window for the last hour, the last 5 minutes? Or is it something related to the number of packets, the records we collected? So it is data-driven, the last 100 readings. So which kind of approach we want to use? And of course, there are differences between these two. Consider that we might have sensors producing events, so they are completely event-driven, and they are not related to time. So we have motion sensors, for example, that are completely event-driven. So here, now, it is important to also understand how are these windows organized. Are they overlapping or not? So in case the windows are not overlapping, which are also called tumbling windows, we have, let's say, an average over the last 5 minutes. And then after 5 minutes, so it's 5 o'clock, we have the average, past five, we have the second, 10 past five, 15 past five, and so on and so forth. Or we have the maximum value over the last 100 values received, the next 100, and the next 100, and like that, we split our values in non-overlapping windows. We split our values in tumbling windows. Another approach, of course, is the so-called sliding windows. So we want to produce the average of the last 5 minutes every minute. Here, a typical example is a wearable device that is measuring our heart rate. So the heart rate is produced as is measured as beats, heartbeats per minute. And of course, we continuously have a value of based on the values collected over the last minute. So every time, every second, we have new heartbeats entering, and of course we have heartbeats exiting our window. The same technique is used to measure the rain intensity, the wind intensity, the wind direction. We are organizing our values in sliding windows. And again, the same thing could happen in case that we organize our windows using the a data-driven approach by measuring the packets. These kind of things are explicitly now handled within our application, our data processing application. We are explicitly handling time by providing these windows. So here, we don't have a file anymore. We have a source. It could also be a file if you want. But here we use the term consumption of data. We are collecting data These are the terms that are being used from a source, from MQTT, from our Kafka message bus. Then we are carrying out certain transformations, like we are organizing them based on the sensor type or the station or the geographical location, and then we are organizing them in windows. Or we could first organize them in windows and then group them. It really depends on what we want to do. And then, of course, we are carrying out the aggregate function. So here, time is now explicit in our program. Another important element that we need to take into account is the so-called window sessions. So we might be in a situation where sensors stop collecting values. They are not continuously collecting values. We are within an industry, and the machine is operated in time shifts. So after a given time shift, it stops. Or it is a car. The car stops. We stop receiving data from the engine. So clearly, now, we have to be careful with our windows, the way that they are organized. Because if we continue to produce statistics, either in a sliding matter or in a tumbling matter, at the point after which we stop having data, of course, statistics will be wrong, and they will not be consistent. So we need to handle this, and of course we don't want to handle this programmatically in our application. We know this should be handled by the framework, or we hope so. And here we need to be able to understand and compute the values between the first value and the last value of the window, or until, let's say, we have the timeout. So we must be able to identify periods of inactivity and essentially stop producing statistics during these periods. Of course, if this is something that we want to do, because maybe this is what not what we want to do. We want to monitor, for example, the traffic in a specific segment of the road, right? So, for example, monitoring the traffic, of course, should take into consideration the fact that during night there are no cars passing by, right? So it really depends on the scenario. In some scenarios, we want to have sessions of inactivity and remove them from the statistics. In other scenarios, such sessions are part of the statistics and we want to compute them. But the fact is that we want these things to be provided to us by the framework, rather than implementing them in code. Because every time we implement something in code, of course we are introducing bugs. Nobody is perfect in writing code. I hope you now are mature enough to have this understanding. This is a junior way of thinking. Every senior programmer understands that writing more code introduces bugs into the system, and bugs are difficult to identify, sometimes are never identified, are hard to fix, and of course this takes time, this takes costs, money. So smaller code, fewer bugs. There are statistics that show that every 10 lines of code we have one bug. Think about it. Every 10 lines of code, one bug. So here you see we can use this functionality and identify the gap that we are assuming here between sessions, and we wish the framework to identify these gaps and exclude them. Now, another important point that we need to take into consideration, especially within this IoT architecture that we've started developing, we need to consider the fact that there is a delay between the time that our sensors have collected the value. Okay, so here I'm using the code developed by Nicola in Python to generate values. So here you say more or less the same thing that everybody did. The station is producing data, and this is the timestamp of the computer running this script. Then, of course, we have the delay, the latency in the network, until this value arrives to our broker, to our cloud-based infrastructure. And then, of course, we have the delay until this packet arrives to the processor. So we have the event time, the time when data were collected, were received from the hardware sensor, when the event actually happened. And then we have the processing time, the time when this data entered the system. And this, of course, is measured by the system clock of our of our processor, of our data processing, let's say, server. So which one do we use to organize our windows? Is it the same? Should we completely ignore the data of the events? What if data arrive to us out of order? So a very nice example here, Star Wars. Of course, the different episodes came out in a mixed order. So how should we process them? Based on the time that they came out to the cinemas, or based on the time of the actual timeline? This is a very, very clear example. So if we organize our windows based on the timestamp of the Apache Flink machine, it's going to be like this. If we organize the windows based on the time they were produced, of course, it's going to be completely different. And this, of course, is very, very reasonable to happen in a case where we have devices that switch off in order to save energy, stations that are located far away, and we might have packet drops because of low signal quality, low because of interference over the wireless medium. It might be the case because we are producing a lot of data. Our mobile phone is producing a lot of data, and we are mobile, so we are in an area where network connectivity is not so good. We don't have a really good connection. And then when we go back to an area where we have good connectivity, we have bursts of all these packets, of all these events entering our system. So you can see here on the right side these packets organized by the processing time are going to look completely different than those organized by the event time. Here again, this is another reason that streaming is not real time. In order to be able to organize them based on the event time, we have to wait so that all those packets that are received out of order essentially are properly placed on the correct window. So we have to delay our processing. Or even if we process the first packet, then we have to reprocess it if we receive the first window, if we receive a packet out of order. So here there are certain things that we have to do to make sure that event time is respected. And of course this is part of the framework, and we are going to go into these details with a hands-on example. So now we will look into Apache Flink. Apache Flink is a mature framework. It has started more than 10 years ago, and it was a result of research work done at a group of institutes at Berlin, and then it developed into a mature platform that was accepted within the Apache incubator in 2014. That's about 5 years ago, 6 years ago. And of course, now it is a really mature open source product, a mature open source product that it's being used in different live systems. There are many use cases that you can study, very, very interesting, on how Apache Flink can be used to carry out certain tasks. And there are many presentations on real systems like Netflix and how they use Apache Flink. So Apache Flink is ready to be used. And Apache Flink is part of a bigger landscape, the landscape of data analysis, big data analysis, data science, if you want. And indeed, this is a very, very complex, this is a very, very dense landscape. And you see that this is just part of the landscape. So Apache Flink is a batch processing framework. It could also be a real-time processing framework. But there are also other frameworks, other tools that are available to us, which can be combined with this framework. Some of those you have started looking into as part of your first assignment, and of course you will examine them depending on the application, depending on the platform that you are developing, depending on your needs. So this is an example on how Apache Flink works. This is the approach of Spark, Apache Spark. This is the approach of Hadoop. This is the approach that Google introduced with the MapReduce parallel processing paradigm. So here we have a cluster of processors, of workers, and one of them is the master, which is responsible for distributing the tasks to the cluster. It's responsible for collecting the outcome of these tasks and is the single point of communication between our Apache Flink clients. So our program is executed within our client process. This process does not require too many resources. It could even be our laptop. Here you have these code examples we saw earlier, which are analyzed and optimized by our client, and then they are sent to the cluster for execution. So here, when you have a command which says read a file or connect to a data source, you need to keep in mind that this does not take place in the client, because it's not the client that is going to actually execute this task. This will happen somewhere within the cluster. So of course we need to be careful that these data are accessible, are available to all these machines. Now, of course, in the background there are different components, and this is transferred to the master as a series of API calls. So every time there is a transformation function here, a grouping, a kind of an aggregate function, these are API calls. So the program is translated into a series of API calls, which are collected by the master, and then they are distributed to the different nodes. These API calls dictate how streams will be built, and then what kind of streaming processing will be carried out by the so-called streaming runtime. And these elements of the architecture are in communication with the storage streams, and of course all these are controlled by the cluster manager. Now, a few words about MapReduce. I'm not going to go into the details. Again, here there are many nice tutorials that introduce the concept of MapReduce. Again, big data computing course and algorithmic methods of data mining course are dealing with this MapReduce paradigm. The main idea here is that the tasks that we want to execute essentially are repeatable. So we want to compute the average, let's say, temperature for every station of our system. So we have 1,000 stations. For all 1,000 stations, we want to compute the same average. So we have to compute the average 1,000 times every hour. And here, these tasks are completely independent. It's not like there is a chain of tasks and the output of one task will feed into the second task and so on and so forth. There is no dependency between the tasks. So we can assign them to different processors. So we organize our data based on the sensor. We organize the packets of each sensor within windows, and then the computation of the average for each window of each sensor is a completely independent task, the so-called inherently independent tasks. So here, these operations can be executed by different machines, by different processors, and as a matter of fact, we don't care which processor which will carry out its execution. And interestingly, within this MapReduce framework, we are also randomizing the assignment in order to make it much faster. So we have our stream, we have an operator that is carrying out an operation over this stream and is transforming the records and changing the values of the records. So this transformation could be one-to-one. We are picking the value and we are reducing, evaluating for each value if it is above or below a threshold. And we are converting it to a true-false value. We are translating a timestamp. We are converting the timestamp from one time zone to another time zone. These are kind of one-to-one tasks. Or we might collect many values, all the values, 10 values within the window, and compute a single value. Take a pair of value and compute the average, or identify the minimum of the maximum. So we have a series of transformation that are not necessarily one-to-one. They could be one-to-many or many-to-one. And each one of them produces a new data stream, a new data set, that is then fitted into another operator, and like that we have a so-called pipeline. And this pipeline of a series of transformations, of map, of reduce, there are many, many different commands here, of indexes, of aggregates, of filters, and joins, create our data processing task. And the idea is that each one of them can be split to independent, is independently executed to each record of our system or to each window of our system, and that's how it can be easily parallelized. So now let's go into the details and let's see some examples here. I'm gonna switch to some code. Here we will work again with, as we said, with Apache Flink. A good way to start is by going into these getting started examples. There are certain tutorials that you can follow, and there are certain examples that you can again consider. As you can see, of course, the batch examples are the ones that are immediately given to us because they are easier, but of course we can also look into the streaming ones, as we are going to do today and now. Okay, so now we will start with some we will look into some simple examples of Flink. Here I will use Amazon Web Services and the IoT core of Amazon Web Services to carry out these examples. Here I have set up a device where the values are published from the first assignment code. So here is the code. This code will connect to AWS, and it will produce the values from for one station. I'm not gonna do it for a second one, just one. I think for the example now it's enough. So these values arrive at the topic station. So here they are. Every second we have the values transmitted. We have the station ID, this timestamp, which is in this format. And then we have five values. This is the JSON. Okay, so this is the MQTT broker in the AWS IoT Cloud. And now we want to connect to this in order to receive some value. So here I have a program which is a very, very simple program in Java. This is the main function where essentially we start. This is the first command. This is a typical example of Flink. We want to configure the system. We want to access the stream execution environment. So this is essentially provided to us by the JVM, and through this we can execute commands. So you see that here we start, and at the end we are executing our job under a given name. So what's when I execute this stream listener, essentially I will post a job to my local machine. There is no cluster here. This is very convenient. Since I am like this, I am able to test my program and develop my program without requiring a complex setup or the existence of a cloud-based infrastructure. Then, when my program is ready, I can use the outcome of the compilation, a jar file, and submit the jar file to the cloud, to the cluster, to the Flink cluster, and have it executed in the cluster. So now I'm not going to use any cluster. As soon as I run this command, it will run on my local computer. So here I'm using IntelliJ to write my code. This is a project where I'm using Maven in order to compile and use all the necessary libraries for Flink. This code is also available on GitHub if you want to check it out. Here you see I have all the dependencies of Apache Flink. I'm using version 1.10 with a streaming connection. Actually, the RabbitMQ is not required. I can remove it. I also have some math functions. I have the AWS IoT JSDK and the examples. I have the JSON so that I can parse the JSON files, and then I also have the login framework. That's it. And then the build is only is based on this stream listener. This is how I can create the jar if I want with this Maven plugin. But essentially, I will not need that. So this is how all the dependencies to Flink are included. And here, the program is very, very simple. I create a new stream, which is a stream of byte arrays. Here I connect, I start from the environment. I request to add a source, and this source is this AWS IoT MQTT stream. And that's it, nothing else. What I do immediately after that is I print the values and I request this print to be done essentially using one executor. Here, of course, we can follow this and thanks to Maven, we can also download the source codes and read the Java doc. So the parallelism is for the sync in the way that the print will happen. And this will execute will be executed as one job. So if I run this, it will compile, of course. And as you see, it will start, it will create, it will set up the environment. It will register the runtime. Anyway, it's various debug messages for the Apache Flink. And then here, the IoT MQTT stream will connect and will start receiving values from the IoT cloud. And that's it. So this is a very, very simple example where we attach to the stream and we just output the values that we are receiving from the stream. And that's it. So I will stop it. And I would like to go into the details a bit of this. Okay, I will not go into the details now. Let's continue to do something more complicated, and then I will come back to this. Okay, so the second example here is you see that the values received let's go back here. So here you see that the messages received are the JSONs, the JSON objects created by the server. So this is what we are receiving from the server, a series of JSON represented as byte arrays. So the first transformation that I would like to do here is convert these JSON objects. So this AWS stream is it has all the JSON objects, and I want to convert them into Java objects, so that then I can carry out tasks. So this will be done by a map transformation. I create a new stream, which is based on the previous one, where I'm using a map transformation based on the parse measurement function. So here is the function. It is implementing the map function interface, where we have this tuple. This is the original type of the record, and now we are allowed to change type. So each map function takes one record and creates a new one. So it's a one-to-one transformation, a strict one-to-one transformation. And of course, we are allowed to change the type of the record. So this is what we are declaring here, that we start with a byte array and we make it station data. And station data is our model. So this is a simple POJO object where we have the values of the sensors. I use here double. We have the station ID. And here I have a string for the timestamp as an intermediate value. So this is the timestamp where I just put here, we are going to put here this value without parsing it. And the parsing will be done in a second step. So here we are using JSON, JSON by Google, to parse this byte array, assuming that it is in UTF-8, and instantiate a new station data. That's it. So this is the task, the function that will be executed once for every record. So you see that this is an inherently parallel task, in the sense that even if we have 1,000 records, or if we have just one, the function will be executed once for each record. The input will be one value, one record, and it will generate one new record. So if we have 1,000 tasks and we have 50 machines, we can distribute these 1,000 tasks to the 50 machines completely independently, completely randomly. So this is now the first transformation. And this is what Station Listener does. It gets the byte array, and now it is transformed into station data. And then I define here a second map task, which is the time parser. Here, the time parser again implements the map function, which assumes station data and will also produce station data. So now we are not changing the type of the data. And here we will use the simple data format in order to parse the values from the received from the sensors. So now we have a second map task, and this essentially concludes our processing. So then we will print the resulting stream, and this is the task. So if we execute this, again, initially we get all the values from Flink, and then here you see initially the values collected from the AWSQ, so these are the JSON objects, and then these objects are converted into station data, and you see here the timestamp converted into a date. If we are gonna merge the work into one map or keep them as two different maps is a matter of flavor. It's completely up to us. This is how we want to structure our MapReduce program. The overall concept, of course, is that tasks should be small in size. But if they are really small, maybe they will create an overhead. But this is completely up to us on how we want to develop this. Now, let's move to the next example, where we would also like to carry out some processing. Here we have this window listener. This is a bit more longer in size. So here, the first thing we do immediately after connecting to the environment is to declare that we are now interested in using the times of the events in order to organize the windows, and not the processing time, the timestamp of Flink, that is. Immediately after that, we again connect to our stream. This is exactly the same as before. Again, we transform the JSON objects into station data, and then we also parse the time. So now we are at exactly the same position as before. And what we want to do now is create a new stream where we will assign timestamps and watermarks. That's how we are using the terminology. So now we have this timestamp extractor, which takes an event. So this is based on the station data, and we use this extract timestamp in order to provide the event time. So this is something internal. We have to program this and explain what is the timestamp. And we use exact same time, that is the time of the packet, as the watermark. So this is the function. And this is what we do here. So essentially, we go through one by one all the elements, and we, like that, we are declaring the event time. And then the next step is, given this event time, to create our windows. So here we have a data stream, again, of station data that is based on this stream that now also has timestamps and watermarks, this time stream. And here we want to create windows which are made up of 1 minute. Of course, here we can declare different sizes. And then we are also allowed here some lateness. Of course, this is really big. We can say that we can accept packets arriving even 1 minute later. And in case that such an event arrives 1 minute later, we will recompute this. Or otherwise, if it arrives later than 1 minute, we will just drop the packet. So it's a kind of leniency here for packets arriving out of order. So this is how the windows are created. And given this particular window, we are now using the reduce step, where essentially we want to combine pairs of packets. This is how reduce works. We take randomly pairs of rows for each given window. So the window might contain 60, 100 packets. It really depends on the packet generation rate. So in this example, it should contain 60. If everything goes fine, it should contain exactly 60. So we take these records, and pair by pair, we are invoking this reduce function. So the reduce function is about a data type, and the result is of the same data type. So it's not like map. In a reduce step, we cannot change the data type. So we have the function invoked with two inputs, row A and row B. And what we want to do is get these two rows, records, and the result, create a new one, which is essentially the average of these two. So you see that we create here a new value. This value is from temperature, the A temperature plus the B temperature divided by 2. And we do exactly the same for all 5 temperatures. So we take the average of each pair of data, and then, since in this example we have only one station, we don't care about the station, and also the time, it's not important. We just pick the smallest time. So this is the reduce step. It will take pairs and will continue this until we get one value for each window. So this is what the reduce will do. We'll pick all the different packets and render them into a single packet. So this is our result stream. And then we want our result stream. We can even output the result stream. So like before, we can just output this and see what's how it looks like. Result stream. For now, let's comment this out. I will come back to this immediately after this. Okay, so let's have a look. Let's start this again. It will connect. It will start the server, and now we start receiving values from the AWS MQTT. We started at 08:25. Let's see. Nothing yet. No output. There is one packet almost every second, with various messages in between. And somewhere now we should receive. Let's see. I think it should be somewhere here. Here it is. Okay, so here you are. This is the station data produced. So you see it's 08:25. It has the smallest value. This is the reduce step. So in the reduce step, in our average values function, you see we get two records, and we use the value of the time, the smallest time between these two values. So 08:25 was the first one. 08:25 was the first one, right? Here it is, the very first packet we received from the queue. And here, this is the output. And then we have the average temperature. So although the packets have different temperatures, within this hour, all these are grouped together and they are the same with happens with humidity, the same happens with wind direction, and so on and so forth. So every 1 minute, all these values are grouped. Here is the 0900. Some packets were lost for some reason. This is the second one, right? I don't see another one. Yes, there is one here also, 0913. Maybe it was the window there was not created properly. And then we have another one, 1053. And like that, here we have again 1000. So these are the packets that are arriving out of order. And then, of course, an update of the value is produced. There are semantics on how to make this exactly once, this computation, but I don't want to go into to the details now. Okay, so this is a window operation. Of course, now that we have done this, we can continue. We don't need to stop. Our program, our processing can be as complex as we want. So now, of course, we need to store somewhere the output. Here, a possible way is to send the output back to the MQTT broker. So we want to transform to using a map function again the data from this station data object into a JSON string. So now we are using again the map transformation. This now is going to be for the output of the reduce. So it's going to be one value for each window. And this will use the extract JSON, another map implementation of the map function interface, where we now get start data objects and the outcome, the output of this map reduce function is a string object. So the function is doing the exact opposite of the parse measurement function. We get a station value, a station data value, and we convert it to JSON using the JSON library of Google into a string. That's it. Very, very simple map transformation. So now that we have this as a string, we can immediately post it to the MQTT, and here we use an MQTT sync. This is the terminology. So we have a stream, this JSON stream. We declare that this stream should have a sync, and this constitutes our final stream. So now the values produced, okay, we will print them to our console, but this is completely independent of the fact that they are going to be submitted to a queue. And here we are going to use the topic Flink. So let's have a look. Let's start again the window listener. We start, we connect to the AWS queue. Values are being received. one by one, and after the first minute we will get the first window. Here it is. So this is the first station data that needs to be posted. It is converted into a JSON, with JSON into a JSON object. Here it is. And now we want to submit it to the AWS IoT. For some reason the connection was lost, then there are some retries, and eventually the connection succeeded and the packet was transmitted. So we can go back here to the console of AWS IoT and listen to the Flink queue, and you see now we get the messages from the Flink processing. So although packets are being published every 1 second, after the stream processing packets are posted on windows of 1 minute. So shortly we will receive the outcome of the second window. So in some sense you could intervene this processing element and now have your website work like it did before, but instead of subscribing to the raw data, subscribe to the 1 minute aggregate data. So this is the second window, and you see that since this is the the sync, Flink makes sure that we are receiving packets once, and we are not getting multiple outputs in case that some events arrived out of sequence. And of course inside each packet we get the average values. So this is a very, very quick and short introduction to Apache Flink. Yes, and this is the new one. Yes. There are many, many other examples available. The only thing that I didn't present was the IoT MQTT stream. This is something that I developed because it didn't exist. Usually Flink is not connected to MQTT streams. It's connected to Kafka streams or RabbitMQ strings. But that's fine. We can develop our own source function and similarly our own sync function. So here I use the code provided by the AWS IoT SDK to build my own MQTT source and MQTT sync. The only tricky part here is that this essentially is executed, as we said, not by our machine, but it is potentially executed by a machine of the cluster. And due to the map reduce transformations that are executed one after the other, and also due to the random assignment of tasks to machines, we need to essentially reopen the connection every time we want to submit and invent. This is a difficulty of the implementation. The same holds with the source. The constructor is not the place to set up the connection. The connection should be done within the run command. Every time that the run is executed, we should reconnect to the client. And the same holds with the key store and the values. We need to make sure that these are loaded in the constructor, and then they are serializable so that they can be transferred to all the machines of the network. These are some peculiarities of this MapReduce interface, where we either have to have access to a common file system, like a Hadoop file system, HDFS, which is common to all the machines that make up the cluster, or make sure that there is a way to exchange data which is location agnostic. Otherwise, we are going to get weird error messages and have our programs crash. Anyway, that's another story that it's not for now. What we have done here in this program of about 30 lines is to compute all this to compute the average value for each window of 1 minute. So now, if we want to compute the average value every 1 hour, so have both minute and hour, of course we need to create a second task and have it running as a different task. If we want to have another calculation other than the average, this is going to be a third task, and so on and so forth, where each of these tasks could post to a different topic. So this is the way that we develop applications under this map reduce task. And now I will stop this publisher, and I will also terminate this. Anyway, you see that as soon as the input stopped, also processing stopped. There are some events coming out, but there's nothing produced. Okay, good. So this was a very, very quick introduction to Apache Flink. So from this architecture, we didn't go into a batch processing concept. We went into a stream processing concept, and instead of storing data into our data store, essentially we are pushing them back to our broker. So this arrow here is not accurate. Good. So remember this picture we saw about it. We discussed about it a couple of weeks ago, maybe more. We need to keep in mind the volume of data, the way that we have structured our architecture. All these values described by Cisco here, all these different gigabytes, terabytes, megabytes, and eventually petabytes of data need to go to our cloud-based infrastructure. They need to go to our AWS IoT cloud, which, by the way, I just remember that I have left these things listening. Good. And of course, this creates a load on our network, as we discussed again and again many times. But on the other hand side, it gives us the benefit that we can develop our system within a week. It also gives us the benefit that we can write our processing application using Apache Flink and have everything there up and running really fast based on stable technologies. That's true. Of course, we also discussed about the edge-based approach. We discussed that there are certain limits and maybe we will never be able to reach this level of petabytes as described in the connected factory or as discussed in the public safety. And we also need to keep in mind the period that we are going through now, where we have increased requirements from our testbed, from our network infrastructure and from our services. You see that now that everyone is at home accessing the network, we have delays, we have websites, we have web services, cloud-based web services that are going slow or they are completely disrupted, like ordering stuff from websites. It is evident that there are services that are not scaling as they should be. Or maybe they do scale, but the cost of transferring all these values, all this data to the cloud is really, really big. And then again, executing them at the cloud is also incurring large costs, which are not available to the municipalities. So it's a matter of volume. It's a matter of budget. And maybe if we move processing from this stage four, from the cloud to the edge, we might be able to perform the same tasks at the local level and maybe save energy, reduce the transmission costs, the network costs, but also reduce the overall operational costs. Or we might also be able to move the execution even lower within our gateways, within our stage two processing, and reduce even further the overall load. Going back to the Gaia project and the smart school architecture, remember the edge-based approach, where a sub-part of the processing is moved from the cloud to the edges of the network within the gateway of each school, where we have a local database to store the results of this continuous data analysis. Now users can locally access these values, since most of the times they are interested on the values produced by the local building. So a hospital, for example, is accessing the records related to the patients located in this particular hospital. The people in the area are accessing the values of the local supermarkets. They are not interested about the warehouses and the amount of products available in other regions. So it is the local values that are important. And then, of course, because there are also other users that are indeed interested at the high level information, we also have aggregated data exchanged between these two infrastructures. So this is a way to move. And of course here one could argue that we can move Flink from the cloud infrastructure and execute it either at the edge or even within a powerful gateway, as we did right now with my laptop. So if you have a machine even within a Raspberry Pi, it could utilize the single core architecture, or maybe we don't have a Raspberry Pi, maybe we have a more powerful gateway device that could even have access to some powerful GPU to take advantage of the multi-cores of the graphics processing unit, but still do it in much lower power than the hypervelocity data centers in the cloud. So it doesn't necessarily have to be a very, very low-end machine. It can have some reasonable power, where of course we can execute Flink. Okay, so this essentially is a way to view our network. So from the bottom level, where we have all the different sensors creating these islands of local networks, which are connected through the gateway to the network core, and at the end the data are out to the cloud. Here we introduce a new plane, the so-called edge computing plane, or using a different terminology, a fog layer, where we are now in the position to carry out some basic analysis of the data, to conduct some stream-based analysis, or if you wish also some batch-based analysis, and then forward through the network core the resulting data to the cloud data centers. So in this sense now we have four layers in our system. We move from or three if you want, depending on whether the network core is a separate layer. So from the initial view of the system, where we had the left side with the wireless networks and the right side with the cloud system, now we have the introduction of a new layer, this stage 2, stage 3 layer, where we can carry out this analysis, where we can execute Apache Flink, or of course we can carry out, we can use alternative frameworks, which essentially brings us to the next and final part of this lecture. Recently we have an alternative which is called Apache Agent. It's now a project which is also part of the Apache incubator. It used to be called Apache Quark, but now it has changed named, it has been renamed, and it's part of the Apache incubator. So this is the official, or maybe not, this is not the official website. This is the official website of Apache Agent. This is a microkernel style runtime, which is meant to be light, really, really have a small footprint, so that it can be embedded in gateways and in general in edge devices of small footprint. So the idea here is to introduce a framework which is which looks similar to Apache Flink. Of course, it's not going to be the same. It will allow us to execute such kind of MapReduce graphs like the ones we saw in the example. And of course, it will be able to run within the gateway with a small within a gateway of small resources, of small capabilities. So here we have again our device, and like before, we have multiple analytic tasks running. So the idea again is the same. There's going to be one task for windows of 1 minute, there's going to be another task of windows of 1 hour, and so on and so forth. Or there's going to be one window for averages, another task for anomaly detection. So we have multiple tasks. In this example, two analytic tasks based on agent that are executed, and then the values, the outcome of these are forwarded to our broker, to our message hub on the cloud, where we are going to carry out the central analysis, our cloud-based analysis. So this is the Apache agent scenario. And again, here there are guides that explain to us how we can get started and how we can create some tasks in agent. Here I have created some examples on my own, similar to those that we used earlier with Flink. So I will try to reproduce the environment. Here now, remember that we are in this in between the SN broker and the MQTT broker. So I will not connect to AWS IoT to retrieve the data. I will connect to a local MQTT broker. And here I will use a variation of this program that will post these values. It's identical values, but posted on the local MQTT broker and not on the cloud. So here, this is again an executable, a very, very simple executable. We get access to the so-called development provider in analogy to what we did in Flink. Here we have the concept of topology, where we start by creating a topology. We create a connector, and now we subscribe to this broker, and we have a stream of messages arriving from this broker. In contrast to JSON, to Apache Flink, sorry, here MQTT is given to us, is implemented for us by Apache Agent. So you see here, this is the main channel to receive data, MQTT. So it is expected that we are going to receive values from MQTT, while in the case of Flink, it was supposed that it is expected that we will have access to something more powerful, more rich in terms of features and functionalities than MQTT, like Kafka. Nevertheless, here we are at the same level. We have messages arriving in string format. And now we want to declare a map function. And here things are defined in a much easier way. So you see that we are also using inline functions, where for each value, we are making this transformation by using the parse function of this the map function of the parse measurement class. So I try to organize a bit my code, but this is of course not necessary in Apache Agent. Recall that these are supposed to be lightweight stream processing functions. So here I'm doing exactly the same thing I was doing earlier in Flink. I just merged the two map functions into one. So we are transforming the JSON object into station data. Station data is exactly the same. It's exactly the same object. And then I'm also parsing the date. That's it, nothing else. So here we are doing this, sorry, station listener. We are doing this map, and then we are just outputting to the console the result. Let's have a look about this simple example. So we connect. You see the values arriving from the queue. Here we are one by one transforming these queues into station data. So this is the output. This is the sync. It's declared in a much simpler way for its value received, for its stream data. We are writing using a simple println. So like that, we could just output something to a file, and we could have something extremely lightweight like this. Now Apache Agent also integrates a console environment. It has an integrated Jetty server. Of course, we can disable this to reduce the memory requirements of our system. And you can see here that how the topology looks like. So we have the source, which is receiving packets from the queue. We have the first transformation, then we have this is an internal part. This is the first transformation, the map. So you see we have 97 packets received and 97 packets transformed, and then we have the sync, which is actually just receiving input and not producing output. And of course this we can increase the interval. We can also have a count here if we want, and we can also pause this. So that's it. This is also a nice tool provided by our Apache Agent. So this is our first very simple topology. You see the idea is similar to Flink. Of course, everything is much more straightforward, less structured, since we are not supposed to do complex steps here. Okay, so the next example is the example with the windows. Up to this point, we are at the same level. Again, we connect, we receive our messages, and then we are converting them into station objects. And now we want to create a window. And here, Apache Agent does not support all the nice time-based window semantics implemented by Flink. Here we can work only based on data, data-based Windows. So here we declare the number of packets that our Windows should have. And we state that this should be tumbling Windows, the so-called independent Windows. Of course, we can have them as also sliding Windows, but we cannot work with time anymore. We have to work only with number of packets. So here we are going to create Windows, which are essentially containing a number of packets for its window. So it's a window of station data, and this is the way to declare it. So given now that we have these windows, the reduce step is now called bats. We are going to do it like that. So we get a list of station data. And what we want to do here, have this list aggregated based on the temperature element of each packet and compute the max and the min. These are generic functions which can easily support multiple aggregations. So here we can request also the standard deviation. So here I create a map. This is a typical hash map where we have the specific aggregates for the temperature as elements of this hash map. So now we are going to have three different entries. And then there is another map which involves the values of humidity, and like that we can introduce as many maps as we want, and of course carry out different aggregation functions like we want them. Then all these different values are combined into a new hash map where essentially we have a nest of maps. So this is now a new stream where we have, like before, one value for each window. The window contains all these station data values, which are now processed once using this BATS transformation that creates a map containing the outcomes of this organization. Now, this map is converted into a JSON object. So we have a new stream, which is essentially a stream of strings, of JSON objects. And then, like before, we create a sync where we just print the results. Let's have a look. So here, again, we start. We get the console. And now, of course, we need to wait for 10 values until we get the first window. So here you see, this is the aggregated value. We have the rain, where we computed only the sum. Then we have the temperature, where we computed the max, the mean, and the standard deviation, and then for humidity, where we computed mean and slope. So you see here, this aggregate n function is a generic function. It takes as input a collection. Then we provide an inline method so that we can get the double value from this for each element of this collection. So this is a generic declaration. We don't know exactly what is the type of these objects, but we don't care. We rely on this function to convert them into double. And then we have a list of multiple parameters that declare the kind of aggregate that we will execute on these values. So you see here we have max, we have mean, we have different kind of implementations here, like count and so on. And of course, we are free to provide other implementations and extend this function as much as we want. And this is the resulting code. So you see here now, the idea is clear. We have the initial we have the initial source that is producing these packets one every second, because this is the sampling rate of our sensors. This is how fast the values are arriving from the sensors. Then these are converted with a map function from JSON into sensor data. You see here we have one-to-one transformation. The number of tuples remain the same. And then we organize them into windows of 10 values each. You see here that they are immediately reduced in size. And of course then, after the aggregates, we're doing this final map step where we are converting them from sensor data, map, these result maps into JSON objects so that then they can be output to the sink. And these are the intermediate queues. This is a very nice way to visualize the topology. And of course here, this is a graph. We can have multiple, we can implement multiple aggregations, as you can see here, and create complex execution paths. The last example includes here posting the values, publishing the values back to the MQTT queue. So here I'm using the agent topic to post the values. The rest are the same. Okay, I have some different aggregation function here. Let's execute this new topology. Again, we get to see the performance of this topology. So this is the first values coming out. And here you see that we have a branch. And why do we have a branch? Because essentially we have a sink that goes and publishes this. And then we also have a second sink, which is the output to the screen. And then we also get some statistics on the different steps of our topology. So this is a nice visualization to understand the stream-based processing path. Now, going back to the console, here we can subscribe to this agent topic of our local MQTT client, and here you see the values arriving from agent. For every 10 packets, we only get one. And you see here we get all the aggregates. So essentially, we can combine all the different headers into one header and transmit it to the cloud. Or if you want, we can also give it a try and make it look like our original, let's say, packet. So we could have here just the average mean. So we have one for its value. We have five values. So it's humidity, it is wind direction, it is wind intensity, it is also rain. And then here we have get rain height, here we have get wind intensity, get wind direction. So these are the five values, and then here we can have something that looks like our original packet. So how does it look? Our original packet, we have temperature, we have humidity, and from here we only need a mean, temp result. What is the problem here? Okay, so we might want to convert this into some kind of result map and not a multi-valued result map. So a single value is enough. Well, it's not that easy. Let's just use a single map. A classic Java hash map. Okay, so now we have humidity, we have temperature, we have wind direction, we have wind intensity, and we have rain height. And now we have the conversion to a JSON object, and this can be done using JSON like before. So we can have here JSON to JSON. Here I missed something. This is J. J. It should be map return. Okay, maybe it will work. Who knows? Let's have a look. There is a problem with the compiler. What's the problem? Okay, maybe we need to declare this here. Yes. Okay, let's have a look. Maybe it's not gonna run. I'm missing. It's gonna work like that. No, it's not gonna work. I need to do it like this, most probably. No. Well, I'm not lucky. I have this aggregations. Yeah, I'm not sure. I have no. What is the problem? From JSON to JSON. Well, no, I'm not so lucky. Let's go back to the previous approach. Let's include all the values. This is not the time to experiment. Now let's do this, right. So now it should work. So now we have all the values within the window combined into one value. Okay. So with this, we conclude also this short demo on Apache Agent and the capabilities. And actually, with this, we also conclude the fifth lecture. So again, if you want to discover the lecture, we can do that over Google Classroom. You are free to post on Google Classroom, or you can also use Google Meet either today or one of the following days. We can chat directly through Google Meet and discuss all the issues that you want to bring forward, any questions. And of course, finally, also through email. Again, thank you for listening. And from starting from the next lecture, Francesco will pick up and will continue with the next lectures. Thank you and bye-bye.